Hello everyone, my name is Gitanjali Semi and I'm currently interning at Lexis & Company, and the topic for today's video is Doctrine of Colorable Legislation. This comes under our Indian Constitution. Now for the first, we must discuss its definition and then the historical background of this doctrine and then the meaning and ambit scope of this and some landmark cases and the limitations for this. Now legislation is considered as colorable when a legislature have no power or legislative competence enacts legislation that is camouflaging that it appears to fall within the legislative competency. Now the objective lies in the fact that what legislature can't legislate directly, it cannot go beyond its competency to legislate it indirectly. This principle is also known as colorable legislation. Now the historical background for this doctrine is the evolution of this doctrine dates back to the time of colonial period when the self-government had increased its presence in major part of British Empire and Commonwealth. The legislative subjects then were segregated between the central and provincial units, and to keep a check on the power to grant these units, any enactment was tested against the doctrine of colorable legislation. From there, the doctrine found its way to India that used the Canadian and Australian legal precedents to adopt the principle of this doctrine. Now in India, the power was given to the judiciary to apply to this doctrine while deciding on the legislative competency of union and state legislature. The expression of this was given by Just Aladhi Krishna Swami Iyer on Doctrine of Colorable Legislation given in the Constituent Assembly debate as it is accepted principle of constitutional law that when a legislature, be it the parliament at the central or provincial legislature, it is invested with the power to pass a law in regard to particular subject matter under the provision of this constitution. It is not for the court to sit in a judgment over the act of the legislature. Now coming to the meaning of it, it must be said that what cannot be done in simplified form, that what cannot be done directly, it should not be done indirectly. This doctrine is used in the cases to determine to question the competency to enact law when a legislature oversteps its conferred power and legislate upon something indirectly which can't do it in directly manner. Now on the face of legislation, the subject matter of law seems to fall within the power of legislature, but related effects on purpose of the matter actually falls beyond the domain and authority of judiciary. So in a manner, the doctrine limits the overstretching or misuse of the granted constitutional power in a conferred manner. This is why this doctrine is also famously known as fraud on the constitution. It is to note that the doctrine is not applicable when the impugned legislation does not fall under the legislative competence of the legislature. The meaning and scope of this doctrine are well explained in a case by a Supreme Court in the case of K.C. Gajapati Narayan Deo versus State of Orissa, and you can be clear about it, in which the court said, if the constitution of state distributes the legislative power amongst different bodies which have an act within their respective spheres marked out by specific legislative entries, or if there are limitations on the legislative authorities in the shape of fundamental rights, questions do arise as to whether the legislature in a particular case has or has not, in respect to the subject matter of the statute, in the method of enacting it, transgressed the limit of its constitutional power. Now, legislature can't overstep the actual constitutional provisions, which can be by applying indirect manner to do so, otherwise it stands in violation of constitutional power granted to them. Now there are four kinds of limitation which can be described as it is not applicable in the cases where the power of legislature is not limited by constitutional provisions. It does not extend to the cases of subordinate legislation. The intention of legislature while passing an enactment is irrelevant to decide its enactment and its validity, and there shall always be presumption of constitutional validity in favor of the enactment. Now there are many landmark cases, but we'll discuss only two, And in the case of Sri Prithvi Cotton Mills versus Broach Boro Municipality, the CJ granted legislative competence and stated that it is not sufficient to merely declare that the court's decision will not bind, as it is equivalent to reversing the decision in the usage of judicial power, which the legislature does not possess. Now, a court's decision should always bind in all situations unless the conditions are fundamentally altered. Therefore, it is accepted that when the premises of decision is genuinely changed by legislature, then there is no case of exercise of judicial power by the legislature. In the case of Bihar versus Kameshwar Singh, it is the only case where a statute based on colorable legislation has been declared invalid. In this case, the Bihar Land Forms Act 1950 was held unconstitutional on the ground that although it is ostensibly purported to lay down the principle of compensation, it did not lay down any such principles and therefore implicitly attempted to deprive the petitioner of any compensation. Now, if an act is made by legislation can be enacted, the judiciary holds the power to declare it unconstitutional and limited under constitutional provisions. A judiciary is there to always balance what can a legislature do and what comes under its ambit or not. That was all. Thank you.